Phil, I'm going to ask you one last question. Certainly, your 5 years coming up, this will be the last one for you. I think we'd be remiss in not mentioning your lovely, long-term wife of 53 years, Anne, who's had to pass away in 2008. She certainly inspired several beautiful compositions you wrote, including the Studying Tune Waltz and the Dan Gurney wrote Lean Out. I recall Anne saying that when you were practicing the wolf trap, the only time she could talk with you was when you were having a meal together. She said you couldn't eat and play at the same time. It's obvious Anne strongly supported and enabled you to pursue music. Tell us what she gave to your music making throughout those 53 years of marriage. And I'm not trying to make you tear up.
Anne was from Longford, and she immigrated to this country in 1951, I believe. In fact, I think it was January 13th, her birthday, her 20th birthday, she landed in New York. And as luck would have it, I was living in New York at that time. I relocated to New York. I was working for Polaroid. And that's the time of the 3D movies when they first came out. You know, the cardboard glasses and so forth. Well, I was calling the control inspector for them. And they were using two cardboard manufacturers in New York, one in New York, one in Brooklyn, to make these things. I was called the control inspector. That's how I wound up in New York. So I used to go to the taxi to Baltimore. And ultimately, they wanted to send me to, somewhere, Pennsylvania or something. But every weekend, every Friday night, I could fly home originally. And they would pay for that, and I could fly back on Sunday. But then they were going to say, now you can only come home down once a month. And they were going to ship me off to someplace. I don't even remember it, but I said, that didn't sound too good to me. But anyway, I hung around New York and I hooked up with the old AP supermarket chain, the Atlantic 50 company. And their main office was in Wall Street, New York. And I worked with buyers there. Anyway, I was doing a little playing in the tuxedo ball, which is an Irish ball. I don't know if you remember me. You know, an Irish and American brother and sister. Very, very popular, did a lot of recording and things like that. Mary Catherine has, her and her brother had separated them in two different ways. Mary wound up with a band in the Tuxedo Ball in New York, and I wound up playing with the band, and that was great. Everything was going good, and I forget what it was. I injured my shoulder. It wasn't a big thing, but I had to have my arm in a sling for about 10 days, something like that. So I called up Danny Devon, who owned the ball, and I told him what had happened. And I said, I can't play for just a couple of weeks. I said, but I can come down if there's something else you want me to do, and call him, or help out or something. He said, yeah. He said, maybe you can help the guy in the football and give you a nice pay. I look out, and back then it was very common for one of the bands, any of the bands, a band we would call a lady's choice. And now the girls would feel free and comfortable about seeing some guy, oh, I like to look at him or whatever, and go and say it's a lady's choice. Yes. This is very, very common, very popular. And here I am, my arm in the sling, and I'm talking to Danny Devlin. Right to the cloakrooms of a separate room, right off the ballroom, stands on like right in the doorway. And this lovely young thing walking around, kind of surfing, talking to him. Finally, she tapped the shoulder. It's a lady's choice. You can dance. I said, I would. That's how I met my wife. And I was gone right then and there. But a year later, I moved back to Boston, and I brought Ann back with me. I moved in back in with my mom and dad, but up the street, on the same street, was a house that a girl I went to school with, her mother owned that house, and she used to take in, you know, somebody like that. So I went up and talked to her, and they said, you know, we have a room for it. So she'd sleep up there and whatever, and she'd have the meals with us, and one thing and another. Then, ultimately, we got married. The thing is that Anne knew from the get-go that I have to play this. Just the same way I have to breathe for each, I have to play it. And I remember before we got married, 6 months or so before, we went for a day to Springfield to see some music friends of mine, one of which was Tommy Sullivan, his wife. And I told Tommy, you know, in the telephone conversation that Ann and I had asked to marry me, and she said yes. So he said, well, why don't you come down someday and, you know, go to dinner and talk. So what they did was they took us out to a park, a local park, and all of a sudden, I'm with Tommy's wife, Alice, and Anne, my wife, is with Tommy Sullivan, and they're going that way, and Alice is taking me, and we're walking this way. Tommy said, what's going on here? Well, the whole gist of this thing was, Tommy wanted to explain to Anne, look, the wife of a working musician, you know, is to be home, is, you know, I'm a working day, I'm off work at night all the time, and it can be kind of lonesome, you know, was she aware of what this was going to mean? And he told her, or she told me afterwards what he said, he said, you realize, you know, if you, this thing doesn't, you know, work out for you, and you're not happy. If you make him put the music, you'll kill him. Maybe we'll go over the top. He got a message. I didn't know anything about this until afterwards. But she was the wife of the working musician, and she knew it. She was talking to him. You know what you're getting into. But we made it work. And spent every minute we had that we could, we were together. And we raised two kids, Joe Jr. and Sheila. And we had a very, very good marriage. A very, very lucky man to have her as my wife at 53. She died in 2008. Very suddenly. And that's what it is. Now, anybody got any questions?
Thank you again for being so attentive.